This is a Doom Classics recording. No part of this recording may be reproduced in any form or by any electronic or mechanical means, including information storage and retrieval systems, without written permission from the publisher. Edgar Allan Poe. The Complete Tales and Poems. Written by Edgar Allan Poe. Narrated by Roberto Scarlato. Metzengerstein. Pestis eram vivus, mortis tuens maris sero. Martin Luther. Horror and fatality have been stalking abroad in all ages. Why then give a date to this story I have to tell? Let it suffice to say that at the period of which I speak, there existed, in the interior of Hungary, a settled although hidden belief in the doctrines of the metempsychosis. Of the doctrines themselves, that is, of their falsity, or of their probability, I say nothing. I assert, however, that much of our incredulity, as La Bruyère says of all our unhappiness, vient de ne pouvoir être seul. But there are some points in the Hungarian superstition which were fast verging to absurdity. They, the Hungarians, differed very essentially from their Eastern authorities. For example, the soul, said the former, I give the words of an acute and intelligent Parisian, ne demeure que sur foi, dans un corps sensible, au reste, un cheval, un chien, un homme, ne que la ressemblance pour ta jambe de ces animaux. The families of Berlifitzing and Metzengerstein had been at variance for centuries. Never before were two houses so illustrious, mutually embittered by hostility so deadly. The origin of this enmity seems to be found in the words of an ancient prophecy. A lofty name shall have a fearful fall when, as the rider over his horse, the mortality of Metzengerstein shall triumph over the immortality of Berlifitzing. To be sure, the words themselves had little or no meaning, but more trivial causes have given rise, and that no long while ago, to consequences equally eventful. Besides, the estates, which were contiguous, had long exercised a rival influence in the affairs of a busy government. Moreover, near neighbors are seldom friends, and the inhabitants of the castle Berlifitzing might look from their lofty buttresses into the very windows of the palace Metzengerstein. Least of all had the more than feudal magnificence thus discovered a tendency to allay the irritable feelings of the less ancient and less wealthy Berlifitzings. What wonder, then, that the words, however silly, of that prediction should have succeeded in setting and keeping at variance two families already predisposed to quarrel by every instigation of hereditary jealousy? The prophecy seemed to imply, if it implied anything, a final triumph on the part of the already more powerful house, and was of course remembered with the more bitter animosity by the weaker and less influential. Wilhelm, Count Berlifitzing, although loftily descended, was, at the epoch of this narrative, an infirm and doting old man, remarkable for nothing but an inordinate and inveterate personal antipathy to the family of his rival, and so passionate a love of horses and of hunting, that neither bodily infirmity, great age, nor mental incapacity prevented his daily participation in the dangers of the chase. Frederick Baron Metzengerstein was, on the other hand, not yet of age. His father, the minister G, died young. His mother, the Lady Mary, followed him quickly after. Frederick was, at that time, in his 15th year. In a city, 15 years are no long period. A child may be still a child in his third lustrum, but in a wilderness. In so magnificent a wilderness as that old principality, 15 years have a far deeper meaning. From some peculiar circumstances, attending the administration of his father, the young baron, at the decease of the former, entered immediately upon his vast possessions. Such estates were seldom held before by a nobleman of Hungary. His castles were without number, the chief in point of splendor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.